I was walking this morning and was reminded of our message last week. Today, regardless, Pastor Craig spoke to this a little bit, but listen, Faith Bible Church, I was reminded of Isaiah 6 this morning as I walked, and I thought what Isaiah records in that important chapter. And that is, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. That's a lesson we need. That's a lesson we need. In the year in which Isaiah and his culture were trusting in political leaders to bring about what they believed to be the most important priorities, he dies. But Isaiah sees the real king high and lifted up. Faith Bible Church, we need to keep our eyes on who controls our country. I think that's an important lesson for today, and that's our service. And that's what it's about today, the message from Will Ford that you're going to meet in just a minute. I really think it's the Lord's sovereign plan and mercy that Will is here today. As I was walking as well, I was listening to an album that I downloaded, and it was my prayer as I walked, and it was this: Lord, let your glory fill this house. Lord, let your glory fill this house. I pray that that happens today, and I really believe that it will. I believe the Lord's going to honor the request that I made this morning as I walked. If you're watching via live stream, we're thrilled that you're here. We're glad that you're joining. It's going to be a special day. I'm going to tell you just real quick, I'm in the midst of the pandemic and the racial struggles and the political turmoil. I've been getting a lot of book recommendations. I've been getting a lot of article recommendations. People send me links to videos, and I appreciate it. Honestly, I do. No, really. No, that was sarcasm a little bit. I got a link from Lawrence Tucker, and he said, man, you need to watch this video. And I was like, yeah, that's another 40 minutes. I mean, all right. But I did it. I watched it, and I watched it again, and I watched it again, and I sent it to our staff and said, staff, you need to watch this video. And then I emailed the speaker. And I thought the speaker, I thought, probably was Plano, Richardson, McKinney in the north. So I said, when he responded graciously and said, no, we can meet for lunch. I said, well, how about we meet someplace closer to downtown? So we agreed on a place, and Pastor Mark and I went, and we were having lunch. And we said, so now, where do you live? And he said, well, close to Duncanville. Pastor Mark said, well, where in Duncanville? He said, well, around kind of the Greenstone, that area. Mark says, that's where I live. We could have met in Whataburger, for heaven's sakes. But I'm going to tell you, you're going to hear a message today that you'll not long forget. Will has been involved with Christ for the Nations here in Dallas. He is a graduate of Morehouse College, Pastor Craig's alma mater. I asked them both this morning, can anything good come out of Morehouse? Obviously, two things did good come out of Morehouse. He is also a Bible student from Emmaus Road Ministry School in Euless, Texas. He's the founder of Hilkiah Ministries, and many know him internationally, however, for his family heirloom. And I'm just going to stop right there and not tell you anything more about that, because he's going to share in just a bit. Will's traveled around the world speaking in churches and conferences on intercessory prayer, influence in the marketplace, and societal transformation. He's been interviewed by CBS, Eric Metaxas, featured on the 700 Club, and also in national and international periodicals. His recent book that he authored with Matt Lockett is entitled The Dream King, how the dream of Martin Luther King Jr. is being fulfilled to heal racism in America. He's also the co-author with Dutch Sheets of History Makers, Your Prayers Have Power to Heal the Past and Shape the Future. Listen to this. Will is also a recent recipient of the Mantle of Destiny Award from the King Family Legacy Foundation and is currently pursuing his master's in leadership from Dallas Baptist University. Would you please welcome our friend and our brother, Mr. Will Ford.
All right, bless the Lord. It is such an honor to be with y'all today. So if you would, turn with me in your Bibles, John 17. While you do that, I'm going to work on this because I come with props. Kind of a Pandora thing going on up here, right? Everybody's wondering. All the quilt people are like, ooh, it's about the quilt. No, not today, but it is a good quilt. All right. I love John 17. The reason why I love it, we get a chance to hear Jesus praying for us. It's like we get to overhear him praying for us. You ever walked in on somebody else praying for you? Like sneaking, like, for me, that actually happened. I walked in on my mother praying for me once. I was at Morehouse College, it was like 30-some-odd years ago. I'm in my 20s. I was back then. Backslidden knucklehead. There's nothing worse than being a backslidden knucklehead, right? And gonna sneak into my mother's house about 2 or 3 in the morning. Because, you know, back in Atlanta, of course, I'm partying or whatever on the weekends. So I'll come home and I'm there and hanging at my mother's house for the summer. So I go out with some friends, but I slip into the house like 2 or 3 in the morning, drinking a few Michelobes or whatever. I'm a little tipsy. So I sneak into my mother's house and I'm thinking she's asleep, so I'm not gonna wake her up. She don't know I'm out. I get by her door, and she is just going to town praying for me. I mean, just like intensely praying for me. You're talking about a buzzkill. She's praying about my purpose, God's plan for my life, all these different things. I just stayed outside that door, and it did something to me. Well, years later, when I finally fully gave my life over to the Lord, and shared with my mother, I said, Mom, you didn't know this, but I was outside your door one night, and I heard you praying for me, and that... They just marked me and branded me. And she said, oh, I knew you were there. I just wanted you to hear what God told me about his plans for your life. I will submit to you that Jesus, in John 17, he's allowing us to hear him pray for us. He's allowing us to overhear his prayer meeting for us. And you know what? This should sober us up. It should sober up the church, especially after everything we've seen past, few weeks? This whole year, it seems like social distancing has revealed the social distance in our hearts. And here's the last thing on Jesus' heart concerning us. He says this, John 17, look at verse 19. He says, for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they themselves also may be sanctified in truth. I do not ask on behalf of these alone, talking about the 12 disciples, but for those also who believe in me through their word. So now he's praying for us. Turn to your neighbor and say, now he's praying for you. What is he praying? That they may all be one. Even as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may be in us, that the world may believe that thou didst send me. And the glory which thou hast given to me, I've given to them, that they may be one. Just as we are one, I and them, and thou and me, that they may be perfected in unity. So that the world may know that thou didst send me and didst love them, even as thou didst love me. In other words, there's going to be such a profound love and unity amongst believers that a lost and dying world is going to look at that. It's going to provoke them to want to know Jesus Christ. And that's where I believe we are right now. Listen, church, only a united church is going to heal a divided world. It's going to heal a divided nation. It's going to take us. And so we're the hope. It's not going to be the politicians that are going to fix this thing. We need their help with policies, but it's going to take us to reach the human heart. And I want to share with you a story today about how God has connected me to some of his unfinished business with this prayer, and it's connected to God's dream for this nation as well. And so before we get started, let's pray. Jesus, we absolutely love you. God, we give you glory, King of glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. We magnify your holy name. This morning, God, we thank you so much for forgiveness of sins. We thank you so much for newness of life. And now we come before you, Lord, in this moment, even in this time of transition. I love what Pastor was saying. In the year that King Uzziah died, saw the Lord high and lifted up. Lord, in that time of transition when Isaiah could not no longer trust in the arm of human flesh, that's when he saw you high and lifted up. God, we pray right now in this time of vulnerability that we would see you high and lifted up like never before. When all the props are gone, Lord, we would come to know you even more. But, Father, we ask you at the same time, answer your son's prayer and use your united church to heal a divided nation. Release the convicting work of the Holy Spirit out of our midst. And, Holy Spirit, do what you do best and what you love most to do. Make us love Jesus Christ more than we did before we first got started. And we came to this place today. In Jesus' name, everybody say it. Amen and amen. So some of y'all may be wondering what this old hunk of tin is doing up here. This has been in my family passed down for about 8 generations. It's used by the slaves of my family. They used it for cooking. They used it for washing clothes. But secretly, they use it for another purpose. I believe it's actually connected a lot of ways to this dream that Dr. King had. If you would, go ahead and cue up this. I want you to hear this from the I Have a Dream speech. It's so powerful.
As the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will they be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream.
Powerful speech, right? You love this speech. Well, it's interesting. You know, the I Have a Dream speech, we love that phrase. Did you know that phrase, I Have a Dream, that was actually birthed out of a prayer meeting? There was a young lady named Prathia Hall. She was with Dr. King. They were in this house that had been burned down by they were in a church that had been burned down by the Ku Klux Klan. And they go in there, and little Prathia Hall, how do you like to have a name named after prayer? Her father was a Baptist preacher. Amazing preacher, and she was an amazing preacher herself in her own right. Years later, she went to Princeton University Theological School and became a powerful preacher herself. But she's there, 22 years old, in this church that had been burned down by the Klan. Dr. King was in that prayer meeting, and Prathia Hall starts saying in a rhythmic cadence, I have a dream, and she starts naming off different things. Dr. King, of course, he was there, and he said, young lady, you mind if I use that phrase? She said, yes, sir, I don't mind at all. So he incorporated that phrase, I have a dream, into all of his prayer meetings for about a year. He was saying that in all of his prayer meetings. And then he said it for the first time in a speech in Detroit about 2 months before the March on Washington. Mahalia Jackson, his friend, was there, famous gospel singer. She heard him say that. So he gets ready to do the speech in the March on Washington, and his speechwriters, they laid out this amazing speech. But he wanted to add that I have a dream phrase and all those different things in it. And they said, you know what, let's leave all that I have a dream stuff out of it. It's kind of cliche. So he agreed, he left it out. But he gets through reading this speech, and if you listen to the right version, you'll hear Mahalia Jackson in the background say, Martin, tell him about the dream. And then he kicks into it, I have a dream, you know, and the rest is history. But that was all birthed out of prayer. And all this thing happens at the Lincoln Memorial. And so, of course, that's the book where I talk about this in greater detail, The Dream King, and you can get that online. I didn't unfortunately have enough to bring with me for you guys today, but just go to our website, dreamstreamco.com. You can get the book. You can take that down. I want this to be some shameless plug for my book. But the thing is this. I'm going to share with you today a story that only God could write. And this is like the tip of the iceberg of the whole story, what I'm going to share with you today. But what I want to come at this whole thing from the concept of this. God loves to remember, and he memorializes things. Everybody talks about collectors, like you see Jay Leno, he has this show where he collects cars and he collects motorcycles and he talks about the things he collects and how valuable those things are. Well, God collects things too. And one of the things he collects is tears. Another thing he collects are prayers. Revelation 5 and 8 said there are bowls in heaven full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And then in Revelation 8, it says that at some point in time, God collects that incense, which we know is prayer, and adds other prayers to it from, who knows, whether there's people from all around the world or people ages past. At some point, heaven gets connected with earth with prayer because God collects prayer. Acts 8 and 4, Cornelius, your prayers have come up as a memorial before God. And so I want to talk about that concept because we have this God who loves to remember. And he hangs on to these things and he connects us into the unfinished business of other people who have gone before us. Hebrews 11, 39 and 40 says it like this. All these by faith, they were proved for their faith. They were proved for their faith, but let me read this for you so I nail this for you. Hebrews 11, 39 and 40. Says it like this. All these by faith, talking about the great heroes of faith. That includes your mama and your papa and them too. They were approved for their faith, but they did not receive what was promised. So that apart from us, they wouldn't be made perfect without us. In other words, there's a whole company of people, y'all, looking over the balcony of heaven, saying, hey, y'all, don't mess this thing up, because God started something in us that he wants to complete exponentially through you. Jesus said it best when he said, what greater works than these are you going to do because I'm going to the Father? And so he'll start something in one generation and complete it exponentially through future generations to come. He's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He thinks generationally, and he didn't forget the things that he promised people in prayer. He doesn't forget about covenant promises. And that's what I think we need to remember right now in our nation. And I don't think he's forgotten about the prayers of Prayer Hall or Dr. King, all the other people who have gone on before us. He hadn't forgotten about the prayers of a Charles Finney, some of those great revivalists and abolitionists. And he wants us right now to come together right now in a way that we could be the container for a move of God that can heal this nation for generations to come. That makes sense. So the way I'd like to get into this whole thing by talking about that is that, listen, I'm one of those sons of former slaves, and this pot was used by the slaves of my family. They came from Lake Providence, Louisiana. I don't think this is a mistake. This came from Lake Providence, Louisiana. Providence, according to Nelson's Illustrated Bible Dictionary, is the continuous activity of God by which he preserves and governs. It's the way God looks over seemingly insignificant things in apparent accidents. In other words, we had no idea how many things God prevented from happening for us all to get here today. We had no idea how many things just accidentally kind of happened, and all of a sudden we wound up in that job, that promotion, in that place or whatever that met that special person at the right time. In other words, God watches over it all, right? And so there are probably a lot less coincidences than we realize. Matter of fact, in Hebrew, they don't even have a word for coincidence in the Hebrew language. They believe that God watches over all things. And of course, as Christians, we know that Romans 8, 28, God works together all things together for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. So God has this amazing way of doing that. You're going to see that in this story. God's providential hand. My other favorite scripture for understanding providence in the New Testament is Ephesians 2 and 10, where it says that we're God's workmanship in Christ Jesus, and we're walking out the works that he prepared beforehand for us to walk in. The word workmanship is a powerful word. It's the word poema. Everybody say poema. You hear the word poem in there, right? So think about it. You're God's poem. You're his song. But even greater than that, the word poema was the word that was used to describe someone who was a skillful tailor, a fabric maker. That was the word for somebody who crafted a quilt or something or wove something together. They were called a poema, the master poema. Listen, God is this master poema, and I believe he's weaving something together way better than we realize. Now, You ever see somebody put together a tapestry or whatever, or weaving a quilt in, and on one side of it, it looks like a mess, right? Especially if they're crocheting or something. But then they'll say, no, let me show you what I'm working on. And they'll turn it around so you can see what they're working on. That's what God is doing with this little story that I'm about to tell you. So honestly, I hadn't thought much about this kettle pot till I went to a little conference in Colorado Springs, Colorado. I was there, and that's when all these uncoincidental coincidences started happening in my life. I actually got a hunger for revival in America, and I got to this place where all I could do was just walk and weep and pray for revival. I started prayer walking my neighborhood there in Euless, Texas, for a time period, and I read a book by Bill Bright, which said, in the back of the book, he said, God, give me 2 million people who do a 40-day fast for revival in America. I said, God, make me an answer to that man's prayer. And so I go on this juice fast, this liquid fast. The first day of it, somebody spray painted my neighbor's car in my neighborhood. I said, God, what do you want me to do? He said, start prayer walking your neighborhood. How many of y'all prayer walk your neighborhood or prayer walk your campus? Listen, if you don't, start, because amazing things begin to happen. I like the way the Archbishop of Canterbury used to say it. He said, when I pray, the coincidences happen, but when I stop praying, the coincidences stop. That's how you find out what Providence is doing, is when you begin to pray. So I started prayer walking my neighborhood, and at the last of that time of prayer walking my neighborhood, there was this prayer gathering, huge prayer gathering in Washington, D.C., but then I found out some of those leaders were going to be in Colorado Springs, so I go to this prayer time there, but little did I know that Mr. Poema was going to connect me to some more unfinished business. So I get there, and there's this lady praying for a man named Dutch Sheets, who I didn't know at the time, and she calls up another young man named Billy Olsen, who I didn't know at the time, and she starts praying over them, and it turns into this prayer time where they start praying for Williamsburg, Virginia, and praying that something would happen from that place to remind people about the covenant promises that God started at Jamestown. Of course, there are a lot of other things that God started at Jamestown in 1619, but there were other things that got started in that place with Robert Hunt planting the cross and praying for God to use this nation to evangelize all the nations of the earth. Yep. You can take that slide down. We'll get to that in a moment. I'll tell you when to put them up. Thank you. So anyway, so I'm there at this gathering, and she stops. This lady stops. She says, hold up. There's something to this, because Dutch's real name is William. Dutch is his nickname. Of course, Billy, his real name is William. Does anybody know what William means? So I'm there, and I just kind of blurt out from the back, it means noble spirit, resolute protector. She said, that's right. Who said that? I said, because I was just trying to hide in the back. So I just kind of raised my hand up. She said, you're William too, aren't you? I said, yes, ma'am. She said, well, come on down here. And she said, please, come down. There's two white up here anyway. Come on down. But when the three of us get connected together, William Dutch Sheets, William Billy Olsen, me, William III, the Spirit of God falls on us, begin praying and crying out to God for our nation together. And Dutch shared this powerful message. I'm going to share a little bit of it with you in a moment about synergy and how things happen in the natural and spiritually when we connect together and work together, especially in the place of prayer. And so I share with them the history of this kettle pot and how it was used. And so it turned into this prayer gathering we decided to do called the Kettle Tour. We would go to all these different places throughout the country where First Great Awakening, Second Great Awakening happened in our nation, all these historic places, basically which ended slavery. So he said, I'll sing you all the names of the cities we want to go to. So here's the thing. Here's where all the uncoincidental coincidences start first happening in my story. Here's what happened. When Dutch sent me all the names of the cities they wanted to go to on that prayer journey, without realizing it, all of them, except for about two, were names of streets in my neighborhood that I've been prayer walking. For example, went to Jamestown, the original settlement. Jamestown Court was across the street from me. Went to Princeton University. Princeton Street was two streets behind me. Went to Hanover, New Hampshire. Hanover Street was next to Princeton Street. Went to Dartmouth University. Dartmouth Court was four streets down. Went to New Haven, Connecticut. New Haven Court was one street down on the left. Went to Gettysburg. Gettysburg Street was around the corner from me. I mean, I could go on. And if I didn't have the city represented, I had the region represented. For example, we went to the Chesapeake Bay area, and they used to call that whole area the Chesapeake. And at that time, I lived on Chesapeake Street. So why would God do this with a white man named Dutch and a black man named William III? Well, it turns out the Dutch were the first ones to send slave ships into America in 1619. And William III, that king from England, was the first king from England to send slave ships into America. God was saying, I want to use your relationship to show that I want to reverse the effects of yesterday's pain. I'm going to turn the tapestry around so you can see what I'm working on. It's Acts 17, 26 and 27, where God is saying, I made from one blood many nations and determined the bounds of their habitations, time beforehand, that we may seek after God and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. And the thing that connected us together was this teaching he had on synergy. Synergy is when you take two separate things, and when you connect them together, they only create an addition of power, but a multiplicity of power, right? Scientists say if you take two horses and if you pull them together, if they're pulling the same load, it creates so much exponential power, it's as if a third invisible horse has been added. Spiritually, we know that one could put 1,000 to flight and two could put what? 10,000 to flight. That's synergy. So think about it. We start getting all this agreement in prayer between red, yellow, black, and white. Start getting agreement in prayer between old and young, male and female, we can see the synergistic exponential release in the power of prayer like we've never seen before, right? It's like what Psalm 133 says, what, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together, and what unity is like the anointing oil flowing from Aaron's head onto his beard and onto his robe. And then the Bible says, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Listen, y'all, God's looking for a place called there. Honestly, it looks a lot like a place called here. Because I love the unity through diversity I'm seeing in this room, even after the election. Listen, you need to give yourself a hand clap, because I'm traveling around the country. I don't see this a lot, especially during this time period. So give it up for what God is doing in this house. Don't take what you have for granted, right? So you could basically command a blessing from God in that place of agreement and prayer. And I began to understand what that's like, because I have these two little toddler boys, Benjamin and Samuel, and when they're playing and they're fussing, they're fighting, what's the first thing I do? Parents to toddlers, what's the first thing I do? I separate them, right? You go over here, you stay over there. Matter of fact, I think they think that's their names. Go over here and stay over there. But when they're playing in agreement, oh, it's so beautiful, right? They're playing in harmony, they're just loving on each other. I get on the floor with them, I roll around with them. You know, they ask me to take them to get ice cream or whatever, they can basically what? Command it from me. Father God is the same way. When we're operating in unity and agreement, especially in the place of prayer, it moves his heart so profoundly, it's as if we could command a blessing from God. But Doug said something that was so profound in that time while he was sharing at this conference. He said this: not only can you agree in prayer with the person sitting next to you, you can also agree in prayer with the generation behind you. He was talking about how he was at his alma mater, school where I taught for years, Christ for the Nations. He's leading the student body there in prayer. And while he's leading them in prayer, praying for the school, praying for them to get back on the right track, he heard the Holy Spirit say to him, Dutch, I want you to come in agreement with the prayers of the founder of the school. And he thought, hold up, God, is this really you? Because that man's dead. And I know you're not in there talking to the dead. What are you talking about? And the Lord said, I didn't say agree with him. I said agree with his prayers. His prayers are still alive before my throne. I've collected them. But I need this generation to agree with what I want to release through his generation. I want to release the synergy of the ages. And that's when Hebrews 11, 39 and 40 made sense to me. All of a sudden, all these by faith. They were approved for their faith, but they did not receive what was promised, so that apart from us, that we may be perfect without us. In other words, God's looking for another generation to continue on the work of prayer and the work of the Christian work for exceeding generations. In other words, he's looking for a double portion generation. Right? But we have to be the ones to take up that mantle. So when I heard him say that, I also remembered that in Psalm 133 wasn't just about us agreeing with each other today. It's also agreeing with God started in our yesterday. The reason why I say that is because the garment of the priesthood was passed down from one generation to next. And as it was passed down, the oil that was on it was passed on to each generation. So we don't understand that, because when we anoint somebody today, we just put a little oil on our finger and we thump somebody on the forehead and we call it a day, right? That's not how they did it back then. They would take a gallon full of this thick anointing oil, and they would pour it all over that high priest's head. And as the oil dripped down, it went from his head onto his beard and onto his robe. Listen, that one robe was then passed down to the next high priest. But then as he received an anointing to be relevant for his today, as the oil dripped down and mingled with the anointing from the past on that same robe, then that same robe was passed down to the next high priest. In other words, there's supposed to be a momentum-building anointing that goes from generation to generation to generation, the saturation of the ages, if you will. So everybody's looking for the next woman there, I'll lose something, or the next purpose-driven this or that in the body of Christ. Now, those are great titles. Those are great authors. That's not my point. My point is this. God's not after originality right now. You know what he's after? A successor. And to a successor, he released a double portion of anointing alone. They're so powerful, it not only will make them impactful in this generation, but make them a springboard for future generations to come. In the place of prayer, when I heard that, and I got this understanding, I remember this kettle pot that's been in my family. Like I said, it was used by the slaves in my family. They use it for cooking, they use it for washing clothes, but secretly, they use it for prayer. They were owned by a slave master there in Lake Providence, Louisiana, who would beat them for any reason. Praying was one of them. See, back then they wanted slaves to be Christians because they knew the Christian slaves made better workers, but they would pervert the gospel and say, slaves, be obedient to your masters if you want to go to heaven. Now, we know we're saved by grace through faith, not of works. It's a gift of God so that no one should boast. But it was easy to teach slaves that back then because it was against the law for slaves to read and write. It was also against the law for anybody to teach them how to read and write. And so the irony is that while they wanted them to be Christians, they didn't want them to pray because they felt like if they prayed, they would foster hope. If they got hopeful, they felt like they would try to run away. So these folks who owned this pot in my family, my father's side of the family there in Lake Providence, Louisiana, they would sneak away and pray anyway, even under the threat of being beaten, sometimes to death. Let me give you an example of how cruel slavery was on this plantation. We had the story passed down in our family about a great uncle named Uncle Willie who decided to go fishing but didn't ask. And so when he came back from his fishing trip, the slave master decided to make an example out of him. So they strapped him to a tree and put both arms and legs around either side of that tree. They then took a leather strap, which was shredded, which had rocks and nails and glass attached to it, something like the cat of nine tails. And they beat this slave forefather of ours until all the flesh was pulled out of his back. The family, in an effort to save his life, they took a huge sheet, put grease or lard on it to wrap it around his body. They put the grease on the sheet so that the cotton wouldn't stick to the exposed skin on his back. But in spite of their efforts and because of the cruelty, he bled to death and died. So that's how cruel slavery was on this plantation where they were there in Lake Providence, Louisiana. And if they were caught praying, they would be beaten as well. But listen, these folks were Christians, and they decided to pray anyway. So what they would do is they would hold prayer meetings at night to make sure their prayer meetings weren't seen. They would sneak into a barn. But to make sure they weren't heard, they used this cast iron kettle pot. This is the one that they used. It would sneak in, and then they would take the pot and turn it upside down on the cabin floor. And then they would take three or four rocks and prop up the edges so it would be suspended off the ground about an inch or two. They would then prostrate themselves on the ground and put their lips in between the opening between the ground and the kettle so that the kettle pot would muffle their voices as they prayed through the night. And the story they passed down with this pot is this, is that they didn't think they would see freedom in their time. So they prayed for the freedom of their children and the next generation. One day, freedom comes. There's this young teenage girl who decided to keep this pot and that story in our family. Now, why would she do that? She's probably thinking about all those who are dead and gone, who risked their lives to pray for her. She's probably thinking about now all the people who are too old to enjoy the freedom she's about to embrace. So she keeps this pot and this story in our family, and she passed the pot and the story down to Harriet Lockett. Harriet Lockett passed it on to Nora Lockett. Nora Lockett passed it on to William Ford Sr., who passed it on to William Ford Jr., who then gave it to me, William Ford III. So, Maya, I'm at this conference and hearing this man talking about agreeing with the prayers of those who have gone before us, but the unfinished work, the unfinished business of prayer, even in our families. I thought, man, to whom much is given, what? Much is required. And I remember this pot in my family. I mean, you know, as far as this generation is concerned, we could use more time in the prayer room, to be honest. Back then, they had a willing master that kept them from praying. We have a willing master that keeps us from praying. It's called social media. It's called entertainment. I'm not trying to guilt you into the prayer room. I'm just trying to say, listen, if we want to see what they saw, we got to do what they did. We feasted and played. They fasted and prayed. Something's got to change. But then beyond the obligation, I thought about the privilege. I thought, oh, my God, I get to agree with the prayers of my forefathers. Agree with the prayers of all those who have gone before me in biblical history, the prayers of Jesus for the freedom of this next generation. I thought about the exponential results that could be released and created from that. Shared that with my new friend, Dutch Sheets, at that time, and he said, you know, Will, I was praying. I said, God, you wouldn't really want me to take some cast iron cooking pot around the country to represent the prayer bowls in heaven and do this tour with this guy that I don't know? He said, you got to give me confirmation. I'm glad he said, you know, cast iron, cooking pot, because think about it. This pot, yeah, they call it muffled prayers, but literally, Revelation 5 and 8 said there are bowls in heaven, golden bowls full of incense. It's golden bowl because that's how precious your prayers are to God. There's a prayer bowl over your family. There's a prayer bowl over the soda. There's a prayer bowl over this Metroplex. There's a prayer bowl over our nation. God's looking for a new generation to resource the prayer bowls once again. He said, God, you really want me to have some cast iron cooking pot represent the prayer bowls in heaven? You need to give me confirmation. How many of y'all played a confirmation game? My friend Matt Lockett talks about that, right? You make up this really ridiculous thing for God to do, and you say, God, if this is really you talking to me, I need you to do this time, this way, like this. And you know, we're not supposed to test God, but God says, okay, I'll do it this one time just to show him I love him. And then God goes, whoo, and he does it. You go, wow. But if it's really you, I need you to do this. We play these games with God. So Dutch had his Bible with him, and it falls open to Zechariah 14 and 20. Part B of that verse says this, and the cooking pots in the house of the Lord shall be like the bowls before the altar. So here's this cooking pot that's caught muffled prayers, the same way there's a bowl in heaven that catches our prayers like incense. Dutch said this, to me. He said, wouldn't it be just like God in his justice and irony to use the prayers of a slave generation to free a nation up for revival again? So I'm glad he said generation, because it wasn't just black Christian slaves praying back then. There were also white Christian abolitionists who knew that if any person was a slave, was a Christian, then that person was their brother. Listen, they let their lives down for each other. I mean, there was white revivalists and those white abolitionists. They had their houses burned. They were shot. They were killed. They were lynched because they chose to suffer with the people of God rather than compromise and wink at slavery. One of them was a man named Elijah P. Lovejoy. In this town of Alton, Illinois, when a slave was beat to death and nobody else cared about it, Elijah P. Lovejoy decided to become an abolitionist. He bought this thing called a printing press. It had just been invented. And he started sending out throughout all this countryside, all the area where he lived, abolitionist material to change people's minds about slavery, to end it. And many people began to change their minds except for this one angry mob of slave owners who threatened his life over and over again. They destroyed his printing press and threatened his life. So Elijah P. Lovejoy went before his city council and went before the mayor, and he said, listen, it's the duty of the government to protect its citizens. Why aren't you protecting me? And the mayor at that time said to him, sir, if you would just stop preaching what you're preaching and writing what you're writing, that would be your protection. Story is told that Elijah P. Lovejoy begins to weep in front of him. He said, forgive my tears. I shed them not for myself, but for you and others. I cannot stop doing what I'm doing or writing what I'm writing, because if I did, I would fear that the angel of the Lord with his flaming sword would pursue me wherever I'm going. I don't fear man, I fear God. And if I fall, my grave shall be made here in Alton, Illinois. End of quote. His words proved prophetic. The next day, an angry mob came to his house, burned his house down, and as he ran out to escape the flames, he was shot and killed. You think God had forgotten about people like that? But here's what those abolitionists helped me understand. They were willing to fight. Those white abolitionists and white revivalists were willing to fight for the black Christian slave because they knew they were connected together because of the blood of Jesus. They knew they were part of the same history, same family, same lineage. So they helped me understand something. See, if my ancestors had been Muslims or Buddhists, I'd have no connection to this part of his history, because I'm a Christian, right? But because they were Christians, listen, if you're a believer, none of these, my ancestors and forefathers, are yours too. In other words, I'm just as much a spiritual son of Charles Finney and Harriet Beecher Stowe as you are Martin Luther King and William Seymour, C.H. Mason, and Harriet Tubman. In other words, when we come together in that kind of unity, that kind of agreement, church, something powerful can happen. The oil of Psalm 133 can flow. Anointings could begin to mingle. Yokes could get broken over generations. God's just looking for a new generation of people who will drop their agendas and come together and believe, especially in the place of prayer. We have the same history. This is your history, is what I'm trying to say. This is our shared Christian history together. You get this? All right. So it was a group of people of black Christian slaves, white Christian abolitionists. They prayed into being the first and the second Great Awakening. Had it not been for those revivals, slavery wouldn't have ended in our nation. And there was a Supreme Court law back then called Dred Scott, which said that slaves had no rights in the courtroom. But because God sent revival, that law got broken in the hearts of people so radically, people in the North were willing to fight for people in the South that did not look like them. That's why I'm daring to believe, listen, the same God who broke the power of Dred Scott, he can break the power of Roe v. Wade. He can put an end to systemic poverty. He can stop our schools from being a pipeline to prison. He can shut down mass incarceration. He can shut down the opiate crisis in the suburbs or shut down the crack houses in the inner city. He's just looking for a new generation of people who will drop their agendas and come together and believe. Amen? God weeps over all of it all. He weeps over it all. So the Lord began to speak to me about this new movement that he wanted to release, that was going to be release justice for everybody in a powerful way. But he said, you have to deal with your own unfinished business of unforgiveness with the race issue. And so he did that through this dream that he gave me about the dream of Dr. King. In the dream, I'm on my way to Dr. King's old church, Dexter Avenue Baptist Church, but I couldn't get there when I first going to pick up Dr. King. And so in the dream, of course it's a dream, right? So I go by this house to pick up Dr. King, he's alive. But in the dream, he comes out of this house and he has this humongous white duffel bag, which has black handles on it. And in the dream, he starts emptying all this dark garbage out of that duffel bag. Then he throws the bag down violently, and he comes to get into this vehicle with us. And in the dream, I thought to myself, man, that bag could make a nice souvenir. And so y'all, carnal I am, right? Like, even in my dreams, I'm thinking, I went to Morehouse College, he went to Morehouse College, the bag could make a nice souvenir. So in the dream, I get out of this SUV to go pick up the baggage, but before I could touch it, Dr. King grabs me by my shoulders and says, no! Do not go back and pick that up. And then in the dream, he starts telling me what I need to do to heal the racial divide in our nation. I wake up from the dream in tears. I didn't even realize that I had been weeping the whole night in my sleep, in prayer. My pillow was soaked with tears. I shared it with my friend Lou Engle. He begins to weep. We began to pray, God, what is the interpretation of this dream? I said, God, remind me. What did Dr. King say to me? And the Lord said to me, William, the white bag with the black handles, that would be the interpretation for your dream. I realized the white bag represented my white baggage. And the black handles represented how I, as a black man, has been carrying my white baggage around. God was saying to me, William, get rid of your white baggage. You've been carrying it for way too long. So I know what he's talking about, because I know what it's like at 13 years old, myself and two other friends, all around the same age, we were coming out of a convenience store, and a carload full of white guys pulled up next to us, called us the N-word, said they're going to shoot and kill us, and they chased us for about 2 hours. They probably were just joyriding. We didn't know them, but listen, we were terrified. I know what it's like at 19 years old to be falsely accused of shoplifting, and when the police officer couldn't find anything on me, he said ugly things to me to try to provoke me into an altercation. I know what it's like in my 30s to have my first nice house in the suburbs, and for the first 3 months, every week, the same police officer would pull me over just for driving while black. I know what that feels like. But you know what I've done? For every white person and every police officer in that region where I lived at that time, I put those three stories on everybody. I saw everybody through that veil. I prejudged every white person and police officer during that time period. And it's the devil's diabolical plot. It's Revelation 12 where it says the devil is the accuser of the brethren. The word accuser comes from a powerful Greek word. It's the word kategoros. It's where we get the word category. So in other words, the diabolical plot of the enemy is to get us to categorize or stereotype each other so that before we can have one conversation with each other, we put some bad narrative or some bad history or one bad experience on somebody else before we have one conversation with them. God is saying, he was saying to me at this time, listen, get rid of your bitterness. Get rid of your unforgiveness. Get rid of your resentment. Get rid of any guilt manipulation. Get rid of your white baggage, so you can get to a new vehicle that can bring revival and justice for everybody. Right? And that's what he was saying to me. But the question is what he has for the church right now is this. What color is your baggage? Listen, y'all, get rid of it because we need each other. Because only a united church is going to heal a divided nation. So I wound up speaking at Dr. King's old church the day after this dream. And I had this big, huge book called A Testament of Hope. It falls open to the I Have a Dream speech. And I get to that pulpit, and I start reading that speech like a prayer. And I get to this one part where it says, I have a dream that one day the sons of former slave owners would sit together at the table of brotherhood. And for the first time, I thought, man, whatever happened to the family that owned our family where this kettle pot came from? And little did I know that Mr. Poema was going to connect me to more unfinished business. So if you could go to that next slide for me. So my friend asked me to come with him to this prayer gathering in Washington, D.C. And this is that prayer gathering. It's January 17, 2005. But I'm not the one who took this picture. The person who took the picture was a man named Matt Lockett. If you follow that hand with the blue sleeve, you see that's my face there. And some of y'all may recognize some of the other folks there. But Matt came to that gathering because he had a dream. Interesting thing, his father died a year before to the day, January 17, 2004, suddenly of a heart attack. And so he was wanting to know more about his family history, couldn't find anything. And then one night he has a dream. And in the dream, he's praying for revival and praying for a cultural life with a man named Lou Engle. And he wakes up from the dream and he goes, who and what is a Lou Engle? He had never met him, never heard of him before. So he goes through the internet, types in the name of this guy, Lou Engle, up pops the face of the guy that he saw in his dream. He wasn't part of anything we were doing before, so he decided to come to this gathering. So he comes and he takes this picture. I share that night and I start talking about the history of this kettle pot. And he shared with his family, he said, God, this is really you. I have to air my name called or something like that to know this is you. And so I start going through the family history and I said, this comes from the Lockett side of my family. He comes up to me in tears. He said, hey, you said Lockett. I told my wife and my daughters that I need to hear my name called. My daughter elbowed me and said, Dad, he just said our name. Lockett's his last name. I said, how do y'all spell it, with two T's or one? Because I'd never met a Lockett before. He said, we spell it with two. I said, oh, my family, we spell it with one. I said, where are your Lockett's from? He said, Kentucky. I said, oh, mine are from Louisiana. But it was enough, right? We thought it was this cool coincidence. So it connected us as friends, and we've been friends for 15, 16 years, and eventually Matt leaves his job in corporate America and becomes a missionary in Washington, D.C. He's there right now, 16 years, there with a prayer ministry called the Justice House of Prayer. Well, fast forward. After about 10 years of friendship, Matt made an amazing discovery. He goes to pray at Appomattox Courthouse, and as they were coming out, that's the place where the South surrendered to the North in the Civil War. Y'all know the story. Well, they're going to the visitor center and they grab the first book off the shelf and he sees his name again. If you go to the next slide, he grabs a book that starts talking about the last battle of the Civil War, and it's called The Battle of Lockett's Farm, The Last Shot. And he thought, okay, this is crazy. Well, he finds out that the last shot of the Civil War happened in front of the farmhouse of a family named Lockett. Of course, he's hearing his name called again, so he thought, okay, this is another cool coincidence. He talks to his brother, and his brother says to him, listen, I just have been doing a lot of documentation, getting a lot of documentation on this stuff and doing a lot of our family genealogical history. Here's what I just found out just last week. That house belonged to our family. In other words, it's not like a guy named Smith reading about another guy named Smith in history. In other words, my friend Matt Lockett finds out that the Civil War in his family's front yard. Isn't that crazy? So he decided to go there, see if the place still existed. So if you go to the next slide, that's the house, and that's the memorial stone in the front of it. It says, Sailor's Creek, here Lee fought his last battle, April 6, 1865. Right, you historians know 3 days later, April the 9th, that's when he did the unconditional surrender there in Appomattox. And the story goes that the Southern Army was in the front, the Northern Army was in the back. The only thing that separated those warriors was this house. It's still riddled with bullet holes to this day. If you go to the next slide, that's my friend Matt Lockett and his family when they went to visit the first time. Next slide for me. And there's the bullet holes that are still in it from the Civil War. Next slide. And so the owner of the house brings him inside and says, how much do you know about your family history? He said, oh, you know, not much. He said, well, some of y'all left from here and went to Kentucky. And his man says, okay, I know that part, right? Because he's from Kentucky. He said, y'all had huge families, and y'all had lots and lots of slaves. And some of y'all went through the Deep South. And then some of y'all went through Louisiana. And before he could ask him, he says to my friend, man, oh, yeah, sometimes as you traveled across the country, there were clerical errors, and they dropped the T off the end of your name. So that took him back to the first conversation he and I had. So he flies from Washington, D.C. to Dallas, and he lays out all of his research and all this information. We just honestly just talked and prayed and cried. Because if you go to the next slide, my oldest known family member was believed to be a man named Isaac Lockett. And You can't see the highlight there too well, but this is his census there, in the 1870 census. He's living there in Lake Providence, Louisiana. He's 90 years old in 1870, so more than likely, about 6-7 years after slavery, this is probably the place where he was a slave. And so, but in this document, Isaac Lockett said that he was originally from Virginia. Right? So you know our slaves always took on the last names of the people who owned them, right? And sometimes they will be willed off to other family members across the state or friends across the state or whatever. That led to another year of research, and here's what we realized through the empirical evidence that we found. It was my friend Matt Lockett's family who owned my family, where this kettle pot comes from. So think about it. Here's my family praying for the ending of slavery. But then all the way up at the farmhouse of the people who used to own them, slavery comes to the end in their front yard. But then, because he's the God of the past and the future, and he remembers prayer, he connects two people from those same family lines, Matt Lockett and I, and he weaves our storylines together so that we can war against injustice in our day and cry for awakening in our time. Because that's the kind of God we serve. Isn't that amazing? If you go to the next slide for me, so that is the original plot of land there. We actually found the place where Isaac Lockett used to live, Sutton Plantation. The town of Lake Providence asked us to come and share our story, so we asked if we could find that place, that plot of land. So this is that plot of land where Isaac Lockett used to live. So think about it. Somewhere on this plot of land 200 years ago, there was a prayer meeting in the middle of the night where some people snuck in with this kettle pot into a barn to pray for me and to pray for you. Isn't that fascinating? And so next slide, this is us sharing our story together for the first time. We've been sharing it ever since all around the country, all around the world. Next slide for me. And the town of Lake Providence actually gave us the keys to the city. Listen, God is releasing keys of Providence to shut the door to racism and to open the door to revival and to heal this thing more than you realize, because he remembers prayers. Next slide for me. So this is another interesting part of the story. This is Napoleon Lockett and Mary Lockett. They were some of Matt's ancestors. And it turns out that they were like the Southern Belle aristocrats from like the Gone with the Wind kind of family, right? They were very, very wealthy, very, very well known. They were very aristocratic. He owned hundreds and hundreds of slaves. They had 11 children who owned slaves as well. He was a colonel for the Confederacy, and was also a planner and an attorney. Well, it turns out that his wife, Mary, didn't like the fact that the Southern White House didn't have its own flag. So she hired a designer, and Mary Lockett hand-sewed the very first Confederate flag in her house and hand-delivered it by horse and buggy to her friend, Jefferson Davis. In other words, Mary Lockett was the Betsy Ross for the Confederacy. And so she came up with this flag right here. It's called the Stars and Bars, right? But they thought, oh, that looks too much like the Union flag on the battlefield. Let's come up with another flag. And so they came up with this one, which is, of course, the most well-known one. But think about it. Here's the thing that's so powerful. Through the same family where the flag of rebellion was raised up, because God heard the prayers of black Christian slaves and white abolitionists in the same family, I'll get to that in a second, through the same family where the flag of rebellion was raised up, next slide, the flag of surrender goes up in their front yard because God loves to remember, right? So now for about a year, that's all we knew, is that Matt's family owned our family. And honestly, it started working on me a little bit. So the first 3 or 4 months, we're like, oh, my God, it's so cool. Your family, oh, my family. How could God do that? How many people live in America? 300 million people. Look at all the chances. After about 3 months, I was like, hold up. Your people used to own my people. What about Uncle Willie? And actually, some anger stuff started coming to the surface. I was so surprised by that, y'all. I worked it out with Matt some, but mostly it was by myself. I realized I had to get rid of some of my baggage even more. Matt, he said for the first time, he had dismissed the pain of a whole people. But the first time, now he's connected to the pain in the history of a people, and it's connected to the face of somebody that he loved. He loves my family. I love his. We've done Thanksgiving together, all this stuff. And so we had to go to a deeper level of forgiveness and repentance, right? And that's the one, two, those are the two things that everybody's trying to withhold from each other right now, because everybody wants to win. But we're here to tell you this one thing. There's still room at the table of brotherhood. And the first one to love wins. Amen. So we stayed stuck there for a while, but then guess what happened? After about a year and a half, we found out that Matt had another person in his family who was a revivalist and an abolitionist who took a strong stand against slavery. He was a circuit-riding Methodist who traveled with Francis Asbury. And here's what we know about the circuit riders. You couldn't be a circuit rider and own slaves. And then also, they carried three things in their satchel. They carried a Bible, a manumission form, and a hymnal. The manumission forms so that if they preached the gospel and a slave owner, if he got saved, they would slide the manumission forms to him over to him and say, listen, it was for freedom that Christ set us all free. Therefore, go ahead and sign this manumission form and set your slaves free too. We know that's exactly what happened because everywhere the circuit riders went, the free slave population grew exponentially. Right? So yeah, he had slave owners in his family, but he also had abolitionists and revivalists in the same family. It's like all of our families, right? We have these things called what? Generational curses, generational blessings. They represent these dominating themes or storylines, right? Right? I have people in my family, yeah, I've done stuff we're not proud of. I've done stupid stuff, but thank God for the blood of Jesus, right? I have these people back here who are contending for revival, the ending of slavery. Those curses and blessings, they represent themes over families or storylines. And what God is shouting to America right now is this. What storyline do we want to be a part of? The healing or the hurt? The blessing or the curse? What storyline do we want to be a part of? Last story. Let's share this last one with you. So remember, it was against the law for slaves to read and write. And shortly after the war was over, it's still frowned upon because they were still afraid of insurrections. So if they caught black people trying to learn how to read and write, even after slavery was over, it was frowned upon. Well, Lucy Lockett, one of Matt's ancestors, walked in on this mother trying to teach her 5-year-old son how to read. They'd just come out of slavery. And they thought there was going to be some bad consequences for it because they were sneaking around trying to learn how to read and write. And Lucy Lockett said, no, what you're doing is good and right. I'm taking over your tutoring. So she tutored them both in how to read and write. And we know that story because that 5-year-old boy, he grew up. He grew up to be Robert Russell Moton. Robert Russell Moton became the second president of Tuskegee University. He became an education advisor to 4 presidents. And when the Lincoln Memorial was dedicated, if you go to the next slide, Robert Russell Moton is the person who did the dedication speech for the Lincoln Memorial when it was first built in 1922. Isn't that amazing? And then 41 years later, Dr. King would come to those same steps and do the I Have a Dream speech. And then 41 years later, Matt Lockett and I would meet on those same steps in a prayer meeting on MLK Celebration Day. Now, mind you, this happened to 2 men who were led by dreams to the place where Dr. King said in his I Have a Dream speech, I have a dream that one day the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit together at the table of brotherhood. So maybe the dream speech wasn't poetry. Maybe it was prophecy. Maybe there's this dream king. Father is still answering his prayers. Father, I pray that there'll be one so that your glory could come so that the world would believe. Maybe God had forgotten about the prayers of a little girl named Prathia Hall or Papa and them or your mama and them. Maybe there's still hope for our nation even in the midst of our divide because he has not forgotten about all those who have gone before us. It's time for us right now to contend in the place of prayer and be the answer to Jesus' prayer. Amen. Stand to your feet. So I know we're in this intense time period right now where, like I said, social distancing has revealed the social distance in our hearts. And we need the love of God to be released upon our culture and our society more than ever because the culture is sick, y'all. It's going to need us. It's going to need a church like this. You know, it's interesting, that house that I told you about, Matt Lockett's house, that where the Civil War ended in the front yard, the Northern Army was in the back, the Southern Army was the front. Historians say the only thing that separated the armies was the Lockett house. But here's what happened. After the Civil War was over, that house got turned into a hospital for both sides. And former black slaves worked with white nurses to heal the wounds of brothers who had been fighting against each other too long. Listen, it's a picture of the church. Everybody wants to be in the radical right or whatever, or the radical left. You know, to draw a crowd, all you have to do now is draw a line. That's all you have to do. But the people on either polar extremes of those, they think they're the radicals. That's not the radical place. It's not about radical left or radical right. You know what the real radical place is? It's the radical gap. You know why I say that? These folks take shots from each other, but the people in the radical gap take shots from both sides. I think that's why Ezekiel 22:30 says that God is looking for somebody to stand in the... because nobody wants to stand there. But listen, if you stand there, you may take shots from both sides, but you don't stand alone. And you can be the very people that could hang on to all these other folks while they're trying to tear the fabric of the nation apart. The people in the radical gap are hanging on to both sides because they love the people on both sides. They may not agree with the ideas, but they agree with the fact that Jesus loves everybody. And they are dealing with the nuance of trying to understand both sides. That's the one thing neither side is trying to do is understand one another. But in all our getting, we're to get what? Understanding. And so, yeah, there's nuance and there's complexity that we get to deal with. But guess what? We'll get to be the ones that will heal a nation. So, Father, I pray that over this house, over Faith Bible, God, here in DeSoto, God, I thank you for the unity through diversity that's here in this place. I even thank you for the diversity of thought. But God, I thank you that it's not about the donkey or the elephant, it's about the lamb. Truth of the matter, God, is this left wing, right wing, the whole bird is sick. We need the dove back in America. And God, would you raise up this house to contend for the healing of this community, for the healing of the Metroplex, for the healing even of the nation. God, thank you for the amazing leaders that I see in this place. I thank you that you're raising up voices for the voiceless in this time, for this moment, in this hour. And God, I thank you that we're not going to be divided along any other lines, but we're going to be connected about our love for Jesus. Lord, it's not about who we vote for, it's about who we live for. Keep that ever before us. And God, I just thank you that there's still room at the table of brotherhood, where there's no room for unforgiveness. There's no room for bitterness. There's no room for unrepentant hearts. But I thank you for making room for us, God. So Lord, we agree with the prayers of the Locketts for the freedom of the next generation. We agree with the dream that you gave Dr. King and a pray through the hall, that we would sit together at the table of brotherhood. But more importantly, we agree with the prayer of your son. Father, use a united church to heal a divided nation so that generations even yet to be created can praise you. And all God's people said, amen and amen. God bless you guys.
I don't have anything to say. What can you say after that? I appreciate the repeated, almost like a drum, that only a united church can heal a divided nation. Church, own that. Live that out. Listen to the Spirit, what He's saying to you right now. I don't know what kind of baggage you've got to let go, but let it go. Love your brothers, love your sisters, so that the world might know the Father sent Jesus. That's why we're here. It's what we're about. Listen, I'm going to end with this. God is good to Faith Bible Church. Wasn't it good to hear that message after this last week? Now unto Him who's able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before His presence with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God and our Savior, be glory, dominion, majesty, and power both now and forevermore. And all God's people said, God bless you all. You're dismissed. Have a great week.